Welcome back to the Tapes Archive Podcast, where we release interviews that have never been heard before. In this episode, we have Black Sabbath bassist and lyricist Geezer Butler. At the time of this interview in 1992, Butler was 43 years old and was promoting Sabbath's new album and an upcoming concert date in Indianapolis. In the interview, Butler talks about what happened to his solo career, why he left Ozzy's band, what he thinks about music critics, and the Wayne's World soundtrack.
Excellent.
As always, we have music critic Mark Allen at the helm conducting the interview. If you'd like to support the show, please like, follow, and subscribe to us on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and Instagram. There, we post other content and information not available on the podcast. If you'd like to read the transcripts for any of our episodes, please head over to our website at thetapesarchive.com. One last thing before we get to the interview, the Tapes Archive Podcast is a proud member of Osiris Media, a global community connecting passionate fans with podcasts and experiences about artists and topics you love. Thanks for tuning in, and now it's time to open the vault.
Mark Allen, please.
This is Mark.
Mark, can you hold for Geezer Butler,
please? Sure.
Thank you.
Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah. How are you?
Hi, this is Mark Allen. The last I had heard of you before the Dehumanizer album was that you were going off to do a solo career. What happened with that?
Well, I just wanted to spend the time with my family, really. And I sort of took about a year off, completely doing absolutely nothing, just staying with my family. And then I gradually started writing material. And I was looking for a really good singer, but I could never find one. And so I gradually lost interest in the solo sort of side of it. And just concentrated on writing songs. And then Ozzy asked me to do the No Rest for the Wicked tour with him, and I did that.
And then you left his band, right?
Yeah.
Was it a difference of opinion, or you just didn't want to tour at that point, or...?
Well, I finished the tour, and it was a long tour, about 13 months, and he asked me to do the new album, but I did it for about 3 or 4 months, but I didn't really have any contribution as far as the writing goes, so I wasn't really satisfying myself, so, you know, I just said to Ozzy, I'm off. At that time I was talking to Tony, and Tony really wanted me to come back and do an album with him, which led to the Dehumanizer album.
So you started working with Tony, then ran into Dio, and is that how it worked?
Yeah, I'd started with Tony, and then I was in America on vacation, and Ronnie's wife and manager got in touch with me, and just invited me down to a gig that he was playing at. And I went down there, and I didn't know what to expect. I hadn't seen him for 8 years, and it was good to see him. You know, and we just talked about old times, and he asked me what I was doing, and I told him I was doing an album with Tony. And then we left on really good terms, and a couple of months later, he phoned me up and asked how things were going, and I said, you know, writing some good stuff with Tony, and he spoke to Tony, and suddenly that lineup is back together again.
Now, you said when you were trying to do some solo work that you had a hard time finding a vocalist that you liked. Is that because of who you had worked with in the past? Were you constantly comparing them to Ozzy and Dio?
Yeah, because it's for me, it's really strange doing solo stuff, because with people like Ozzy and Ronnie and even guitarists like Tony, you know, they get the idea of what you're trying to do, whereas these other people coming in, I used to have to explain absolutely everything to them. They just didn't have the spirit, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And it's just, I was tying myself in knots in the end. And I just knocked that on the head and decided to just write the music and the lyrics for future projects, some of which ended up on Dehumanizer.
Are you still writing all the lyrics for Black Sabbath?
No, Ronnie writes most of them. Yeah, he wrote them on Heaven and Hell and Mob Rules, and I wrote some on this album with him.
As far as the song for the Wayne's World soundtrack, did you guys have an option to do that first, or was it you were just working on Dehumanizer and somebody approached you?
Well, we've been working about 6 or 7 months writing for the Dehumanizer album, and that was one of the first songs that we had written, and they approached us to do a track for Wayne's World, and they specifically asked for some, you know, a new Sabbath song, and that was sort of looked at the script and what there was of it, and that sort of fitted more than the other stuff that we had written at that time. We did a demo of it and sent it to them, and they loved it and used the demo.
So you didn't even have to re-record it?
No.
Where is it in the movie? Because I was trying to recall it, and I saw the movie quite a while ago, and I can't remember.
You have to have stereophonic ears, I think.
Did it get
It's when he's driving in his car and the Terminator guy stops him.
Oh, okay.
If you remember that part. You can just about hear it in the background.
But at least they made it on the soundtrack.
Yeah, I mean, we just thought, you know, it's not going to do anything. Soundtrack albums never usually do stuff, especially heavy metal sort of soundtracks. And we didn't think anything of it, and the next thing, it's like it's almost up to 2 million albums now. Plus, it got that track was like one of the most played off it on the radio over there, so it was great to get us known. The whole lineup is back together.
Let's talk about Dehumanizer. The idea for it seems pretty fitting. At least, I mean, I don't know what it's like in England these days, but over here it seems fairly fitting as far as the attitude toward government and politics and just general life. Is it pretty much that way over in England as well?
Yeah, I think the whole world is like that. It seems to be more and more the haves and the have-nots. And in fact, the Dehumanizer thing came from a short story that I was writing, and I'm continuing to expand the story now. And that was, it's just a lot of the way I thought the world was going. This is the track for Computer God. I wrote like a 5-page storyline for Ronnie, and he picked out a lot of the lines in the story and used it as the lyrics for Computer God. And the Dehumanizer was part of the Computer God story sort of thing. But it's just a reflection of how I see the world going.
Not a pretty vision, is it?
Nah.
Since I knew I was going to talk to you, I went and dug out one of two press kits that I've ever saved, and it was from the Never Say Die album. It was the, I don't know if you recall seeing this thing, the cover had Black Sabbath, the 10-Year War, and it had a cartoon of you guys. Do you remember this thing?
I think Tony still got one of those.
Yeah, more good press than most, more bad press than any, it says on the cover. I think it's like one of the greatest, most inventive press kits I ever saw, so I saved a copy of it for a long time. Do you still feel that way? Is there still bad feelings or a battle between Black Sabbath and the critics?
Not so much now. They seem to, I think they know that they're on a losing battle.
Yeah.
Especially now that a lot of the new bands are sort of saying that we were their major influence and stuff. And it seems like the whole Black Sabbath thing has been born again, even though most of it is like the original lineup Sabbath stuff, you know. And I think the critics and the people that used to slag us in the 70s are now saying we're the greatest heavy metal band of all time and that we invented it and all this sort of stuff.
There's got to be a lot of satisfaction about that, you know, turning around the critics.
Yeah, but, I mean, in the end, it doesn't mean anything to us. It really doesn't mean anything. It doesn't put money in the bank, that's for sure, to be critically acclaimed. Never even thought about critics, don't take any notice of them at all. It's what the kids like and what the people that follow us. We have to, that's our loyalty.
Do you think of Sabbath as the first metal band?
Not really, because I know all the influences that I had when we were writing the first album. It was just like an extension of our influences around 1968-69.
And what were those influences?
Cream, Jimi Hendrix, mainly. There was a few bands in England that we all used to like that didn't get anywhere. There was a band called Art, and we were all really into that band. They later, I think some of them later became Spooky Tooth.
Art, A-R-T?
Yeah.
That was the band.
I think they made one album. And we used to see them around all the time, around Birmingham, and we used to really like the music that they did, and then they became Spooky Tooth and did completely different sorts of music.
Oh, okay, so I see. Yeah, I remember Spooky Tooth, but I didn't realize they had a history before that.
Yeah, I think there was about three of them that was in Art that became Spooky Tooth.
How does the band, how does Black Sabbath feel to you now? Does it feel right, getting back together?
I don't know, I don't think it ever feels right. It's always, we always seem to be living on an edge for some reason.
Uh-huh.
I think that's what spurs us on. It's just when you think you can lie back and relax, something happens and it keeps you on your toes again.
Has something happened recently?
Well, I'm not going to say.
Okay. Are you getting, now your show here is, I think, October 23rd, so that's in like 3 weeks from today. And so are you still going to be together when you get here?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay, so yeah. It's not that bad yet. Okay.
No, it's just we always have differences of opinions, and just like constantly have different opinions.
It's interesting that you're coming back too at a time that Ozzy says he's retiring from touring. Do you find that somewhat ironic, or does it matter?
Not really. I haven't even thought about that.
You're 43, is that right?
Yeah.
How does this music feel to you? You know, you've been doing it since you were, what, 19 or so?
Yeah.
Does it still feel right to be playing this kind of music?
Oh, yeah. It's the only sort of music I'd really enjoy playing. I mean, it's just part of my life. It's just like having a third hand or something, you know. It really is just part of me. And that was one thing I realised when I was touring with Ozzy. I was sort of just going the Ozzy solo stuff, and I used to play that on stage. It was just, you know, just another song to me. But then when we'd do the old Sabbath stuff, just something would happen. It just used to feel really magical inside, and I really started missing it then. It used to be great to hear Ozzy, you know, to be able to do the old Sabbath stuff with Ozzy singing it and everything. That's what made me miss Tony as well. So when I finished with Ozzy, I went back to Tony, and I forgot how great it was to work with him. And it's still a feeling that I think it's in my soul now, you know, it's just part of me. Just everything's, it's all those memories and feelings, and just the whole release from life, really, is playing those songs.
Just a couple other things, and I'll let you go. I imagine you've been asked about this before, but does a satire like This Is Spinal Tap make it harder for bands like Black Sabbath?
I don't think so. I think Spinal Tap, it could have been... I mean, it could have been a lot worse if they'd have picked on a pop band or a soul band or something, but I think it's just like, because they picked on a heavy metal band, you know, you can see every heavy metal band in that film, really. But then I've seen other bands, not heavy metal bands, that make Spinal Tap look like a serious drama.
Yeah.
I thought it was a great laugh. I mean, it's probably the most played video on any heavy metal band's tour bus.
Yeah, no question about it. And since you guys came, obviously, way before that, it's... you guys set the stage for all that kind of theatrics and such, but wonder these days when bands look at that, and especially with Spinal Tap doing its own tour, if they think, geez, now we got, these guys have taken it too far.
No, I think you have to have a sense of humor about the whole thing. I mean, you know, if you take it really seriously, I mean, sometimes I think of me being a 43-year-old bloke up on stage, jumping about, you know, and, I mean, that's a laugh to me sometimes, but so you can't take it too seriously.
And is there anything else that you want me to tell people? The tour that you're doing now, is it a wide-ranging, you're taking stuff from all the periods of Black Sabbath, you're playing?
Be doing about four from the Ozzy era, about six from Heaven and Hell and Mob Rules, and about five from the new stuff.
And anything else you want me to tell people about the band or you or that we haven't touched on?
Not really, no.
Okay. Well, I appreciate your time, and we'll see you in 3 weeks.
Okay. Cheers, Mark.
Okay. Thanks, Gizmo. Take care.
Bye.
Hey, thanks for listening to the Tapes Archive podcast. Please remember, you can always find more information about the show and the individual episodes at our website, thetapesarchive.com. Until next time, the vault is closed.